Good morning. Good morning. Yeah. So did you sleep well? You had fun. So how's the cafeteria food? You know, beware of freshman 15. You know, but since Cosmo is only 4 weeks, so it's Cosmo 6. You should be aware. So it is a pleasure for me to introduce to you the first Cosmos Discovery Lecturer, Professor Gert Lankreet. Professor Lankreet leads a group, an interdepartmental group called COSMAL, COSMAL. Well, it sounds like Cosmos, but I like Cosmos better. So Professor Lankreet obtained his bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from Catholic University Leuven in Belgium in year 2000, and his PhD in electrical engineering and computer science from UC Berkeley in 2005, and then he joined UCSD. His research is on machine learning with application to computational biology, finance, and music annotations. He creates a group called Computer Audition Lab, where interdisciplinary research is done to build systems that listen to and describe music and sound. In addition, Professor Lankreet is also into music. He is a manager of our Jacobs School of Rock, which consists of rock groups faculty and students from the Jacobs School of Engineering. So who says engineers don't have fun? So let us welcome Professor Lankreet. Okay.
Good morning, guys.
Morning.
You guys doing well? You guys feel like some science and technology?
Yeah.
You sure? That early in the morning? Yeah? You guys feel like some music?
Yeah.
Ah, okay, there we go. All right, so well, I'll offer you a little bit of the boat today. So what we're gonna do today is we're gonna look into building a music search engine. And so why are we gonna look into that? Well, let me start a little bit with introducing why this is important. I guess maybe all of you already know that, but what's kind of interesting is to go a little bit back into history, first of all. And this is going, for me, just a little bit back in history, for you guys a lot. This is from before when you were on this world, 1980s. I'm not sure whether some of you are big music fans and have dug a little bit into music history now and then. But basically in the 1980s, when people wanted to, let's say, produce some music that others would listen to, then what they had to do most of the time is, first of all, they had to dive into a very professional music studio, right? Very expensive, very big waiting lists. You had to be really good to get into these studios, and only some bands could get into it, et cetera, et cetera. But the point was that you really needed, you know, a multi-million dollar type of setup to even get to recording your music. That's how it all started. Now, after that, the journey was still not at the end, because what then had to happen is that music had to be burned on CDs, for example, and these CDs had to get into the store, right? And after all these CDs get into the store, then people actually had to come to the store and buy your music there, and finally go back home and put it in their CD player and listen to the music. This is how it worked in the 80s. This is also how it still worked a little bit in the 90s, but in the middle of the 90s, things really started changing drastically. It started changing drastically such that actually 25 years later, the middle of the previous decade, this model of going into a music studio and buying CDs in the store and then putting them into a player at home to listen to the music is basically decaying very quickly, and pretty much no one still does that nowadays, unless maybe a minority of people. How do people consume music nowadays? Exactly. People go to iTunes, they play music on their iPod or iPhone or any other mobile device, which they've just bought 1 minute before that on iTunes or MySpace. You can just download music from there as well. And how does that music get there? Well, hooray, you don't need a $1 million music studio anymore. No, you can just build something very basic in your garage, download editing software from audacity.com or something else, right? Record the music, 1 hour later you upload it into MySpace or you upload it into iTunes, and 5 minutes later somebody on the other side of the world can actually download your music and listen to it. All right? So instead of paying millions of dollars and waiting years for the music to get into the stores and actually the physical discs to get with the people that want to listen to it into their CD players, right now it takes about an hour to set yourself up, record a song, upload it, and somebody else listen to it. All right, so things have changed a lot. And because of that, what's happening nowadays is that there is a ton of music available online. Like honestly, 20 years ago, the amount of music that you could easily access was maybe in the tens of hundreds of songs, or maybe thousands if there was a really big record store around the corner. Right now, you can access probably about 100 million songs within 1 minute. Just going to iTunes will expose you to 15 million songs, or going to MySpace will expose you to music from about 10 million artists nowadays, which is easily 30, 30, 40 million songs. Okay? So on one side, what we have here is a world where the amount of audio content that is available, add to that YouTube, for example, where a lot of bands also have music videos online, you have millions and millions of songs that are at your fingertips. Now, on the other hand, also the whole space of music consumption has exploded. I mean, everybody can basically listen to music right now. You don't have to go back to your room and put a CD in the CD player, but you can just listen to your iPod or your iPhone. And if you don't have the music you're interested in listening to, you can just go somewhere online to try to get it. But this is exactly now where the problem sits. We have a lot of devices to consume music. There's a lot of music online. But still, it's not so easy to listen to exactly that music that you would like to listen to. Because yeah, it is easy to get a Britney Spears song or a Lady Gaga song from online because you easily know where to find those. But how about tens of millions of bands here that are not as known as Lady Gaga or Britney Spears, but still make really good music, which you would really be interested in listening to in certain circumstances? Let's say, for example, there's, you know, some romantic night, you're going out on a date, you come home with your date afterwards, and all of a sudden, just like this, you wish your iPod could play for you some romantic jazz music. It's not always that easy, right? Because what you would like to is that you come home, you can just tell your computer, hey, give me some romantic jazz music, instead of having to run into your room and figure out where to find some romantic jazz music, and then 2 minutes later not find anything and have to, you know, play your favorite rock music because you don't have anything else, right? So there is a problem here. And the thing is, romantic jazz music, there is thousands and thousands of songs out there on either MySpace or iTunes that would actually fit the romantic atmosphere of coming home after your date perfectly well. But the problem is you can't find it easily because you just don't have it readily available, all right? So the problem here really is that out of these tens of millions of songs that are available online, there's only a very small fraction that people really know about and that actually get sold, for example, in iTunes. In fact, 77% of the songs in iTunes never get sold a single copy of them. So there's a lot of content out here that nobody knows about. All right, and so what we need to do now is we need to somehow develop technology that will make it easier to access this humongous amount of content here and get it onto our iPods at the right time and in the right place. Another example of right time and right place is that as soon as you get out of here tonight, let's say you want to go out and listen to some funky jazz guitar music. Now, unfortunately, you're in San Diego and you don't have a clue where anything here is, right? Now, imagine that you had a system on your cell phone and you could just tell it, I want to listen to some funky jazz guitar music tonight. And as soon as you walk out, it tells you that there's three places within 2 miles of where you are where you could actually go listen to live artists tonight that are playing funky jazz guitar music. Wouldn't that be cool? Can you do that nowadays? No. So that's where we need technology to help us to bridge the gap between what we would want to do and what there is out there. Okay? So that's another example of where such technology would come in handy. Another example, just the last example here, is this is a picture of one of my students. As Professor Tu was mentioning, I am involved in music myself as well. I like to play music. I like to manage music. This is one of my band members of a band in which I played a couple years ago. We played some music in our garage. We recorded it. And then we were curious at some point in time. We were like curious about, like, you know, which other music is out there that would be similar to ours, right? And so the idea that we had was, let's record our music and upload it to Genius, because Genius is iTunes' tool to build playlists, right? So what if we upload our own song into Genius and then see which playlist comes out, then we'll actually know which bands are similar to the music that we are playing. Now, what happened when we did that was this. Basically said, Genius is unavailable for the song MIA, which was one of our songs. Now, what is the problem here? The problem is that the way that Genius works is that it looks at which songs people bought. Meaning that if you buy song ABC and you buy song XYZ, then if I show song ABC to Genius, Genius will make a playlist for me with ABC and XYZ in there because those two songs were bought by the same people. It's a little bit like Amazon, right? People who bought this book also bought this book. This is how Genius works. Genius looks at which songs which people buy, and songs that are bought by the same people are probably similar, they think, and that's why they recommend them within a playlist. Bottom line was that our song was never sold on iTunes Genius, and therefore they couldn't give us any recommendations. All right? So basically, as I was just giving you a couple examples of, there is a need here for technology to bring music to people because not everything is working perfectly well yet. Genius isn't able to make recommendations for all songs. There is no local music recommendation out there, and there is a lot of romantic jazz music out there that you could play on a night after a romantic date if you could only find it very quickly. All right? Now, what is the issue here? The issue with music is that there is what's so-called a short head and a long tail in the music scene. What I mean with this is that if we plot along the x-axis all the songs in the world, all right, and we plot along the vertical axis here the popularity of songs, then what you'll see happen is that there is a very small amount of songs here, this green slice, which is called the short head. There's a very small amount of songs that is immensely popular. This is the Britney Spears and the Lady Gaga. But there is a lot of songs, a humongous amount, millions of songs that nobody knows about. Because it happens to be your neighbor that makes that music, and your neighbor is not that well known, so the only person who knows about it is you, right? And so the problem is that it's mainly these green songs here that make it onto the radio and into the record stores, or into, like, you know, whatever top 100 are made by, you know, certain commercial enterprises. But there is really, except for MySpace and Last.fm, nobody else who really has access to or has listened to most of the songs in the long tail here. And so what we're trying to do in the Computer Audition Lab, which is my lab, is we're trying to find ways to make these songs in the long tail here, these red songs, which are somewhere on MySpace, but nobody knows about them. How can we make these songs a bit more popular to expose these artists to more people? And honestly, to get songs for these artists here, you have to pay money very often, or you find ways around that. But anyways, to access these type of songs here, most of the artists will give them away for free. So there's a lot of free music out there. You wouldn't have to pay anything for it, but the problem is, how can you find it again? All right? So this is the problem, and this is a problem that has been recognized for a couple years by a lot of technology companies. In fact, in the year 2008, there was more than 200 digital music startups in that year alone. In 2009 and 2010, these numbers have even gone up, and the reason for that is exactly what we just talked about. There's a humongous amount of music content there. Making it accessible is a big technological challenge. There are some companies that have managed at solving part of that problem. Think about Pandora, right? They just went public, the stock shot through the roof. They're immensely popular out there. But there is space for a lot more, okay? And so that type of problem is the problem that we are interested in here at UCSD in the Computer Audition Lab, and we're basically building the basic technology that then companies like Pandora incorporate in their products to bring music to people. Now let's think about this for a second. So how do you solve the problem? Well, if the problem is to find what you're looking for, then what do? You build a search engine, right? That's what Google did, that's what Bing did years ago for text documents, all right? How does this work? Well, the way it works is on Google, you type in a search query, you hit enter, and after that, hopefully, the information that you're looking for comes to you. Now, how does this work? Well, the way this works is as follows. First of all, what Google does is they go out there on the World Wide Web, and they get access to all the web pages that are out there. And what they do is then for each of these web pages, they look at which words appear in the web pages, and they make a so-called index out of that. Now, an index is nothing more than a simple table. In the columns of the table, you find all the different documents. Now, this is just an example with three documents here, but of course, on the World Wide Web, there's billions of them, right? And then every row corresponds to one single word from a large English dictionary. And what Google does is they index all these documents by basically looking at, for example, document one and counting how often each word in the dictionary occurs in a document. For example, if we have a document where the word apple appears three times and the word computer appears three times, then we put these two entries into this table. And if we go through the entire document and then count all the words from our, you know, dictionary of, let's say, 10,000 words, which is much longer than what fits on the slide here, right? If we count all these individual words, how often they occur in a document, then after doing that, we have a complete index for this document. And of course, we do this for every document online, so we have billions of columns here. Now, once we have that index, what Google does then is that as soon as you go to Google and you enter a query, for example, Apple Crisp here, then what Google will do is it will look at the document that has the highest word counts for these words that you just typed in. So for example, document 3 here, which has a high word count for Apple and a single word count for Crisp, but on top of that it has both words, as compared to, for example, the first document, which only has the word Apple, right? So what Google then is going to do is going to decide, well, this document probably is more relevant to your search query because it has both words, so it's going to return that document first. And then in the second position, it's going to return the document that has one of the words appearing three times inside it. So the bottom line is really Google goes out there, collects all the web pages that are out there, indexes them into this type of table, and then matches the search queries against this index to return us results. And of course, they have a lot of secret sauce that happens right here to make sure that Michael Jordan, the basketball player, appears above Michael Jordan, the professor at UC Berkeley, and things like that. But the bottom line is that this index here is the core of their technology. Everybody agrees? Once you have the index, you can solve the problem, right? Now, what am I trying to tell you here? What I'm trying to tell you here is that now that we want to build a music search engine, we're basically in a similar business, because what we would like to do now is, given a query, given some type of clue from the user as to which music they're looking for, right? For example, romantic jazz or an example of a song, right? Can you return the right music? Can you recommend the right music to that user? Or sound effects. I mean, this could be a movie director that is looking for some kind of romantic sound effect, right? So there's two type of paradigms usually that are used for these type of search engines. One paradigm is called the query by example paradigm, and that's kind of like what iTunes Genius does. You give it a song and it's going to give you a playlist of songs, all right? For example, I upload my own MIA song and it's going to return to me 20 songs that are similar to it, build a playlist from it, and I can listen to it. The other possibility is what's called semantic retrieval in scientific terms. And basically what that is really the Google search engine for music. Basically, imagine you can enter text like rock with screaming vocals, and the search engine returns to you three songs that are rock songs that have screaming vocals in them. All right? So these are the two types of search engines that one could think about building for music, and that would help people to find the music they like or feel like listening to. Now, there's one problem here. The one problem is that this all by itself looks very similar to text, right? You enter a query, you get a result, but there's one big difference. The one big difference in building a music search engine like this, where you enter some text in a search bar and then get, you know, some recommendations, is that in the case of text, remember, we had a bunch of text documents here where we could just count the words in the documents and then build this index. Now, for music, on the other hand, we have a bit of a problem here, because now what we would like to do is collect all the songs from the world and build a similar index for these songs. But the problem is that songs don't have words inside them. Songs have audio waveforms that characterize them. So all of a sudden, there's a bit of a technological problem here in that building an index for songs For example, counting how often the word angry appears in song one here is not so obvious anymore. We somehow need to figure out a way to assess how angry song one is, and then assess a way how calm or how much drums there is in song number one. For Google and Bing, it's easy. You just go to the document and count the words. Here in this case, this is not so easy anymore. Everybody agrees? So this is exactly the problem that we are trying to study in my lab and in the field of music annotation. How could we somehow relate words that we use as humans to describe music to songs, to build an index and make basically MySpace or iTunes very easily searchable? Right now, how do we solve this problem? Well, before I go there, let's think about something more here. While I may agree that song number one is an angry song, I'm pretty sure that somebody else in the audience here will disagree and tell me that it's a mellow song. Point being is that talking about music is a very subjective business. And in fact, building this index here may be a lot harder, not only because music doesn't contain words, but also because people disagree about what is romantic and what is not, what is mellow and what is not, what is aggressive and what is not. Okay? So that is another problem that we're facing here. How can we somehow tailor this at a personal level? Because in the end, music is more subjective than text documents. So one of the ways to try to address this problem here would be to do what Pandora does. I assume everybody amongst you knows what Pandora is, all right? So it's this website online. You drop a song in there. You either provide them with an artist name or a song title, and then they start a radio station that will play music of that type. Now, does anyone here know how Pandora really works? Like, how do they do this? Like, how do they generate a radio station from either a seed artist or a seed song title? Well, I'll tell you one thing, little part of the solution. You know how long Pandora has been around? Who thinks Pandora has been around for more than 5 years? Who thinks they have been around for more than 10 years? They have been. Now, why have they been around for that long? Well, here's the answer. The answer is that the only way for Pandora to build these radio stations is to have people listen to every song in their database for about half an hour and label them. Basically, they have people to build the index. Now, luckily, they're lucky in one respect. There is a lot of unemployed music artists in San Francisco, so they can easily recruit, right? That's the good thing. The bad thing is, these people still cost money, and the investors originally weren't willing to give Pandora $100 million to just get 1,000 people to do this quickly overnight, right? So the bottom line is that Pandora started really more than 10 years ago, and what they initially started doing was really having a bunch of people listen to music all day long and label it manually. Now, they've gotten quite away with that. I mean, they have really by now labeled about 800,000 to a million songs. But you see, this model is not scalable, right? Because iTunes by itself has 14 million songs. MySpace has a multiple of 10 million. So these guys would have to keep going for another 50 to 60 years before they catch up with that. Now, by that time, there's probably another 100 million songs out there because everybody will be making it in their garage easily nowadays and upload it to MySpace in a matter of minutes, right? So there's a little bit of a problem with their business model in that sense. And so that is exactly the type of problem that we're trying to address here, right? So how can we build that index? Remember, we were talking about the index right here. But how can we build it in a scalable way is really the question. And so Pandora has some answer to that, but this answer here is not very scalable, all right? So what we would like to do is the following. Instead of having humans listen to these sound waves here and then annotate the sound waves with meaningful tags, we would actually like a computer to do that because computers are cheap and can work very fast, right? So the question now is, how do we do that? How can we feed a waveform of any song into a computer and have a computer spit out the most applicable labels for that song, basically replacing the Pandora music artist by a computer. So how do we do that? Well, this is exactly what we're trying to do in my lab. This is exactly the technology that we are developing. Technology to feed a music signal into a computer and have the computer tell us whether it is a jazz song or a rock song or a rap song or not. Now, the way this works at a high level is as follows. In the first step, what we need to do is we need to somehow transform this music waveform into something that the computer understands, okay? And so the way we do that is, first of all, we chop this waveform into little pieces, and then for each little piece of this waveform, we're going to extract some type of mathematical information from it that we can represent by numbers in the computer. And in fact, numbers in the computer are represented by ones and zeros in binary notation. Now, that's kind of like not so important here. What's more important is the type of information we extract from all these little snippets here from this waveform. Now, what do you think is information that's important about an audio waveform that we should extract to somehow try to describe it to a computer? Well, I think one of the main things that you can easily think about is the pitch high or the pitch low? Is it high sounds or low sounds, right? That is one of the important parts that you would really like to extract from the waveform to, you know, tell the computer what type of music it is basically analyzing, right? Another thing that you may want to extract is information about the beat pattern, like is it fast beat or is it slow beat, things like that, okay? Now, all of that somehow is done by what is called a frequency domain analysis of the waveform. High frequencies or high sounds, low frequencies or low sounds. So basically what we're doing here in this first step is we're chopping the waveform into little pieces, and for each piece we are analyzing which frequencies are available in that little piece. And that information is translated into numbers, and those numbers are binarized and provided to the computer. All right? So in this first step, this step is generally known as signal processing. It's not really machine learning. Why is it signal processing? Because you process the signal into a binary representation that the computer can understand. All right? So that's step number one. So now we have the waveform that is traveling through the air stored on a hard drive, right? The second step is that now, and this is where the real machine learning part comes in, is that we have to teach the computer how to distinguish between, for example, a blues song and what is not a blues song. And the best way to think about this is like teaching the computer is like teaching a one-year-old. How do you teach a one-year-old? You teach a one-year-old what a blues song is by making it listen to 1,000 blues songs and then making it listen to 1,000 non-blues songs, and after that, I bet you that the one-year-old will know what a blues song is and what is not a blues song. Well, we do the same thing here with the computer. What we'll do is we'll get some, for example here, four examples of blues songs and one example of non-blues songs. Of course, in reality, this will be more like 4,000 than 1,000, right? Because you want to provide the computer with a lot of examples. But what we'll do is we'll make the computer analyze, let's say 4,000 blues songs and 1,000 non-blues songs, and after analyzing it, what the computer will learn is it will learn which specific audio patterns, these blue things here, are specific about blues songs, and then the computer will say, like, well, if I hear a song that has this very specific blue pattern, which seem to, you know, occur in all these examples of blues songs that I have listened to, and which does not seem to occur at all in the non-blues songs that you have given me, right? And the computer will extract knowledge from that, and the knowledge is that this blue pattern here is indicative of a blues song and can be used by the computer to distinguish between blues songs and non-blues songs, okay? So step one, signal processing. We represent an audio waveform as bits and bytes that a computer can understand. The step two is we make sure that we show the computer a bunch of examples of blues songs so the computer can figure out which typical patterns in these audio waveforms of these blues songs occur. And then the computer will generalize that to, okay, whenever I see a song that has this blue pattern, it is a blues song for sure. And so then you can actually deploy that knowledge to analyze the millions of songs that are on MySpace, and all the songs that have that blue pattern, the computer will categorize as blues. And the ones that don't have it, the computer will categorize it as non-blues. Okay? Everybody gets that? All right, so this is basically, in a nutshell, what we are working on in the lab and what machine learning does. Now, once you have a system like that, what can you do then? Well, one of the things, for example, you can do is you can, you know, pick some random songs, and you can have the computer automatically describe these songs with words that humans would usually use to describe the song. Or otherwise said, the computer can write a little summary of what the music is about in text. And this is exactly what I have given you a couple examples of here. For example, this Frank Sinatra song here was judged by the computer to be a jazzy singer-songwriter song that is calming and sad, with some acoustic guitar, piano, saxophone, and nice male vocal solo, and emotional high-pitched vocals. It's a song with a light beat and a slow tempo that you can listen to while hanging out with friends. Now, what is pretty impressive about this here is that all the words in blue in this little song summary have been determined automatically by a computer listening to the music. All right. So now that we have the song described by words here, we can build that index, right? Remember the green picture? And so basically we're closing the loop now on how to build a music search engine. Because now we have a system that, given a song, given an audio waveform for this song, will allow us to automatically label it with words and basically automatically do what Pandora experts had to spend years on. But there's still one catch here. If you remember this slide here, there is one part of this slide here that we haven't really solved yet. What is the part that we haven't solved so far? Any suggestion? Numbers? Up here, you mean? Yeah, so that part, very good point. We haven't really covered that into detail. I haven't told you in detail how these numbers are extracted. I think it's a little too early in the day to really go into detail about that. But that's a very good point. So if you're interested in that, I would be happy to tell you more about it after the talk. There is a little more easily to digest part that we haven't completed yet here is this second step. As in, who told you that these were four blue songs and this was not a blue song? Or who gave me these 1,000 examples to show the baby that are blue songs, and who gave me these 1,000 other examples to show to the baby that are non-blue songs? Exactly, very good answer. The only way to get that is to go back to people, meaning do what Pandora does. But we have one big advantage here. While Pandora has to label every single song in their database of a million songs, so basically humans have to look at every single song of those million, what we have to do here is we only have to label 1,000 of them with blues, and then we can train the computer to figure out whether the other 999,000 are blues or not, right? Which is a huge advantage. But still, we need these 1,000 examples of blues songs in order to train the computer to then generalize that knowledge automatically to the millions of songs out there. So we could follow some type of Pandora procedure for that, which is what we did. Actually, we had some students in the lab that would just sit at a computer and do the same thing. But there was a couple issues with that. One is that, you know, if you need 1,000 songs for romantic and you need 1,000 for jazz and 1,000 for aggressive, then still the numbers add up. And the cost and the time also add up to get that information. Second thing is that whatever you guys think is cool music nowadays, I tell you, in 20 years from now, your kids will no longer think it's cool. Meaning, people think differently about music every couple years, in fact, every week or every day probably, but over a long time, these differences are pretty significant. Okay, jazz music will always be jazz and rock will be rock probably, but there's really a lot more of these subjective concepts that people's opinions will change about over time. And so we could not really keep these students in the lab for years and years to go to update our models every day. So in order to build something that is more dynamic and can actually consult people at a large scale about their music opinions, what we did is we built an online game in Facebook. Now, I hope you agree this is a little easier to digest than talking about signal processing. What is this about? What this is about is this is an online game that basically brings music to people and brings some music experience to people, but on the back end tries to collect labels for that music from the players. And the way we do this is as follows. So people arrive at the game site in Facebook, and then they first of all choose a certain genre of music that they would like to listen to and play, you know, a couple games on. And as soon as they have done that, they enter a room where one song is playing at any point in time, and that song is playing for a whole bunch of people that are in that room at the same time playing the same games. Now, the crucial part here is that what happens is that while the music is playing, and I'll give you a demo in a second so you'll see how this works when it's live. So while the music is playing, the people are looking at a small mini game right in front of them, and these games are very simple. And the goal of these games is to make people somehow express their opinion about the music. Like, for example, here they have to say whether the song they're listening to is very danceable or not, and whether it is slow or fast. And then they click on a certain position in this square, which indicates their vote. And as soon as they have voted, they can actually see what other people voted on. And the trick here is that by agreeing with other people in the room, you can actually score more points. All right? That's how it works. Now let's rewind 1 second here. So how did we actually get to developing a game to get people's opinion? Well, the big motivation here behind all this is the fact that, I don't know whether you know that, but there is some pretty, you know, popular games out there. And I'm not talking about, you know, the very sophisticated adventure type games or Farmville type games. But let's just think simply about games like Solitaire, right? I mean, who does not have Solitaire on their computer? And who, you know, doesn't play it either on their computer or their mobile phone when either the teacher is teaching a boring class or you're waiting for the bus for 5 minutes or something like that? Meaning that it's one of these games that if you just have 5 or 10 spare minutes, you may as well just, you know, quickly launch a game and play it to kind of kill time for 5 or 10 minutes, right? Now, did you know that the amount of time that is spent by people on a daily basis playing solitaire on one day is enough man hours to rebuild the Panama Canal? This is pretty amazing, isn't it? So, like, basically the amount of time that people waste playing solitaire, just that game, is humongous. And so that was our motivation to develop a game like this. The idea was really like, is there some kind of simple game that we can develop that people wouldn't mind wasting some time on? But instead of wasting time on playing solitaire, they actually waste time listening to music. The artist won't mind that. And second of all, like clicking on some tags that express their opinion about this music, which then we can use to train our computer system. Now, of course, in order to make that work, you have to make it appealing enough. And so one of the things that we did to make it appealing was we made it a competition. And the way that people compete with each other is that when they click here, they don't see what other people click on. But as soon as they have clicked, they see what their friends clicked on. So they know what their friends think. And at the same time, if you agree with the majority of the other people, then you can score a lot of points. So you'll actually try to provide good votes in those games. Now, thinking about this a little bit, one step further, there's some cool things you can do with this, right? Because imagine that now instead of danceable or undanceable, you ask questions here like, well, is this good music for a first date or not? And then you click on an answer, and after you answer, you see the answer of your friends. It gets kind of interesting then, right? So anyways, I'll give you a quick demo here of, yeah, we know all that one too, right? So, let's see here. All right, so now you're all welcome to connect with the herd. And so what's happening now is that, as I said, there's one song playing at any point in time. There's a bunch of people in the room. Whoops, and I didn't mean to click that. Oh wait, what happened? Let's start. That is interesting. Interesting. As soon as I click the laser beam, it restarts. There's a bunch of people in the room here. Right? They're all listening to the same music. Same here. Now you can click on one of the words that you think are most applicable to that song. For example, I click on spooky. Once the time is up here, the system will tell me what all my friends clicked on. And as you can see here, a lot of my friends clicked on the same word, and therefore I get a high score. All right? So now after this game, it goes on to the next one. Now we had to entertain people a little bit too, and it seems people like competition. So we, between each of these games, we also throw in a little trivia round. And then if you're incorrect, you're very unhappy. And if you're correct, you're happy that you're better than your friends. What do you guys vote? Yes or no? There we go. So what do you think the majority will vote on? Let's look at it, huh? Right, so the same thing then keeps happening a couple times. Any preferences here? B? A? All right. B? There you go. B was the right one. I would call, you would say, baby, how's your day? But today, it ain't the same. Every which one do you guys want to click on? Is a yeah, okay. Huh? R&B, this one? Any other votes? If you took it there, first of all, let me say, I am not the one. It seems like some people at least agree with me. There's always some interesting people in the room. So you guys got the hang of that? So what do you think about doing going to college and doing some research? It's kind of fun, huh? D here? Oh, that you guys were still looking at the game, huh? Not the same to me. All right, one more here. Date? Everybody votes on date? This one? Or in the car after the date? Oh my god, nobody agrees with me here. That's so sad. Alright. Well, thanks for your support here. Another one. All right, well, we'll do another one later, okay? All right, so let me repeat your question. Who now feels like coming to college and doing some research, as in music technology? All right, cool, very cool. Well, we'll see you here next year. Let's see. Oh, one more thing here. So what's interesting about this game as well, thinking about it from, like, you know, again, a research slash technology type of point of view, is what's nice about Facebook is that people playing these games come from all types of backgrounds. And in fact, Facebook tells us whether the person playing the song is a male or a female, whether they're young or old, and where in the world they come from. And this is actually an important thing because it helps us to figure out how different people have different opinions about music. As for example, what I'm depicting here in this slide is that indeed, people don't always agree on what rock music exactly is, right? The teenager grandchild versus the grandma may have very different opinions about that. And in order to try to model that as well and make sure that both grandma as well as teenager granddaughter get the right music from the music search engine, we actually leverage the diversity of the users on Facebook to learn the opinions of the variety. Yeah, exactly. You spotted that well. So this is the demographics of people playing the game. And so it's pretty clear that there's a big peak here, but there is still a significant amount of people that play the game as well over there for us to actually be able to model everybody and help everybody with the music search engine. Now, one of the things that this actually also showed us, and this is kind of interesting, so you see there's more males and females that play the game. but still enough from both sides. And so one of the things we actually learned was that when we play games around danceable songs, as it turns out, the female community agrees very strongly on what is danceable music and what is not. The male community, however, 100% disagrees about what is danceable and what is not. So you get some very interesting differences. Also, there's differences in terms of, you know, where people live across the world. So this is kind of like a little bit of an overview of where the people come from that play this game. So the bottom line of this really is that by modeling all these different demographics and, you know, analyzing how males, females, young and old, South Africa versus North America thinks about music, we can really build a music search engine that will be tailored to everybody in this world, all right? And so it's kind of interesting, like, you know, you do research at a university and all of a sudden the International Game Network writes an article about you, things like that. So it's certainly a very exciting field to work on. And here, basically, this is kind of like the concluding slide about the whole system that we're building here, where on one side we have these games that provide us with the training examples, the 1,000 examples to show to the computer to learn what is blues songs or whatnot. And we have a machine learning component here, which is really top-notch technology that makes computers listen to music and then assess whether music is aggressive or not, or romantic or not. And then we link that into some type of Google search engine, which, you know, will provide the right music to people at the right time. And so one of the specific examples about implementing this, for example, is, remember this one here that we started with, one of the examples of problems that we couldn't solve? Well, in fact, the answer you gave was wrong, because the problem can be solved nowadays, and it's called Rock My World. It's in fact one of the apps that was built by one of the students in my lab, who is building this app to address exactly the problem of, let's say that you're in a certain location at a certain time in a city that you don't know, how can you find out about live music tonight of a certain type, for example, jazz music or rock music, and how can we implement this on a mobile device? All right. So this is just one example to tell you that this is really moving forward and really turning into technology. In fact, even at that level that we compared ourselves to the Genius system at some point, about a year ago now, a year and a half ago, and it actually turns out that the recommendations that this automatic computer system provides are comparable to the suggestions that are made by Genius, which doesn't use any computer audition. As I said, in Genius, you know, iTunes doesn't really listen to the songs, it doesn't analyze the audio waveforms, it just looks at which songs did people buy or which songs do people have in playlists, right? So anyways, this is just kind of like a quick conclusion here to say that what I just talked about is not just future science. This is really things that we're working on nowadays and that really enable computers to listen to music, index it, and make it accessible for everybody out there in the world. So concluding sentence, if you're an aspiring artist, throw your music on MySpace, actually upload it to our website, to Rock My World, and we'll make sure that people will find it and listen to it even if they don't know about you. All right? Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you very much for a very fascinating talk, right? So maybe we have time for only like one or two quick questions. Oh. No, sorry.
Who? Oh, me? All right. So like during the slide where you talked about the computer classifying music into different categories like blues, rock, etc. So I'm not sure if does the computer do this all at once? Like what if like it recognizes similar patterns in songs that makes it fall under multiple categories or something like that?
Yeah, that's a good question. So basically the what the computer really does is for every concept it assesses how applicable it is on a scale from 0 to 100%. So it could very well be that the computer says, like, well, this is 80% rock and 60% jazz, 0% rap, you know, 95% aggressive and 25% mellow, for example. So in the end, what we obtain is really like a nuanced opinion about the music.
Okay, so then...
You know how people have differing opinions on music that you said? is it possible to use the history of your history of what you chose for certain songs on the game to like make it a bit more you for the music that shows up when you search for it?
Yes, and that's exactly what we're doing as well. So we're doing it at different levels. We're basically looking at that at the higher demographic level, like, you know, male versus female, young versus old, you know, Beverly Hills versus Johannesburg, things like that. But we're also looking at it at a very personal level, because in the end, music is, you know, a very personal experience where we certainly identify ourselves with a bigger group, as well as sometimes with very personal tastes, right?
Okay, maybe one final question.
I read an article that said that MySpace might close down this year. What would you guys do then?
Oh, well, you know, no company closes down just like this. So in worst case, they sell MySpace for $1, and then I would buy it.
No, they said no.
Okay, with that note, let's thank the speaker again.
Here's a... Oh, thank you. Awesome. Okay.